वेलकम स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू दिस लाइव सेशन। लेट मी वेलकम अनिकेत गलांडे, सौरभ कराडे, चौगुले प्रतीक्षा, ज्योति जाधव, स्वप्निल कांबळे, कृष्णात गुरव, माळवी किरण, पाटील अंकुश, माने किरण, मे बी सम ऑफ यू आर वेटिंग टू जॉइन दिस लाइव सेशन। वेलकम टू दिस यूट्यूब लाइव लेक्चर बाय योर टीचर डॉक्टर सविता देसाई। वेलकम टू BSc केमिस्ट्री थर्ड ईयर क्लास। इन दिस वेरी फर्स्ट लेक्चर we shall be discussing about various learning management systems that we are going to utilize this year, because you know the situations very well, due to which we have to go through such technological support, and that is why I am going to share with you the study material of this class on various platforms which are available on the internet. So this is my first lecture on YouTube Live. You will get acquainted with this technique day by day, and I will be also improving along with you in my this venture. Few more students have joined us, welcome. In today's lecture I shall be giving you some information about the various platforms that I am going to use for your convenience to share the study material and to keep you engaged throughout the year in our studies, because BSc Part 3 is a very crucial year, very important in your career, and chemistry is a subject where you need to have the help of your teachers. So I am there to help you, and I will be helping you in understanding this subject thoroughly with full interest, and I will be sharing with you all the study material that we can collect. So this is the first platform that I am going to use, that is YouTube Live. As far as possible, I will be happy to conduct lectures in this particular mode. You will come across the advantages of this mode eventually. You can share your questions in the chat box. Your attendance also can be known from your names which you have written in the chat box. Of course, your questions are welcome. So let us begin with another mode. This is my YouTube channel. The name is Make It Easy Chemistry. There will be lot of videos coming on this particular channel. You will be notified if at all any new video I upload on this channel. You are requested to subscribe this channel as early as possible so that you get the information about the updates. Few more students are joining us. Let me welcome Komal, Alnash, Dhanashree, Shrutika, Vaishnavi, Santosh, Praveen, Sangram, Shubham, Manasi. I can see your chats over here. So this is the YouTube channel named Make It Easy Chemistry. You may remember this logo of our research laboratory. Some more platforms I shall be using. These are namely Edmodo, BSc 3 Solution, this is the class. You can see, as I have invited you on WhatsApp group, 32 students have already joined this platform. Here in this, we are going to have a discussion box, like it's very similar to Facebook, where you can write down your queries regarding your topics. I will be posting the announcements, the tests, quizzes, the class timetable, results, etc. in this particular interactive platform. You can join this class using the class code or the link that is shown here. So this is another platform, Edmodo, you can join. Remember well, you need not join every platform or all the platforms you need not join. You can join any one, because all the material that will be shared with you will be the same. So you are requested to join any one of the platform. There are advantages and disadvantages of every platform. So it's better to know little, at least little, about every platform. This is Edmodo. Another one is Canvas. Here also you will come across the announcements. If at all you join, your names will be appearing here. Of course, I have collected your email IDs, and very soon I shall be sending you the invitations to join this class on Canvas. Here also you will come across the files. I have uploaded here the syllabus of BSc 3 Chemistry 2021, the PDF. There are notes of this topic solution over here. PowerPoint presentation is also there, and some of the videos which are very relevant to this particular topic solution are also uploaded here. So this is another useful platform named Canvas. Very soon I shall be sending you the invitations to join this platform. So this is Canvas. Third is the Google Classroom. You can join this classroom using this particular class code. This also will be shared with you very soon on our WhatsApp group. So using this class code, you can join this class. There are various study materials which have been uploaded over here also. Notes are there, the PowerPoint presentation of the topic is there, and same videos for further reference and study have been uploaded here. So this is the third platform where you can get your study material. So I have given you the information regarding Edmodo, Canvas and Google Classroom. This year it is the need of the time that we have to join the classes only in the online mode. So due to this situation, it is quite necessary for all of us to get acquainted with this new technology so that we can come together online, get whatever information we need and progress. So this will be my first lecture. I shall be beginning with the topic solution from physical chemistry. The topic is very interesting, very simple. If you know very little tricks that I will tell you, then there will be no need to even study that topic further. Of course, for your preparations, it is very important to understand the concepts. If you understand the concepts very clearly, then the topic is very, very, very easy. Okay, so let us begin with this topic named solution. What comes in our mind if we talk about the solution? What is solution? Yes, solution is a mixture of minimum two constituents. One is solvent and another one is solute. What is solute? What is solvent? What is solution? What are the different types of solutions? And why we are going to study this topic this year? And what is so interesting in this? Why it is included in the physical chemistry? What are the interesting features of this topic? Let us begin with the introductory part of this topic. Solution. So let me go to the first slide of this topic. Of course, you must know the syllabus has been revised for your class BSc Part 3, and a new syllabus is to be implemented from this June 2020. The overall structure has been modified, and now the first paper in this year is in organic chemistry, then organic chemistry, third is physical chemistry, and fourth one is analytical and industrial chemistry. So that there is shuffling of the subjects in this new structure of the curriculum. This is choice-based credit system syllabus, and the papers are in organic chemistry, physical chemistry, and analytical and industrial chemistry. The theory examination, there will be four theory papers of 40 marks each for each semester, and their titles are given below. You will find this full copy of the syllabus on any platform of our learning management system. Or even if you insist, I shall be sharing this copy on our WhatsApp group. Of course, this document is This document is available on the university website. The practical examination will be of 200 marks, and the distribution is physical section 60 marks, inorganic 65 marks, and experiments from organic section will carry 60 marks. There will be a project for which 15 marks have been assigned. The duration of the practical examination will be of 3 days, and each day the student is expected to work for 6.5 hours per day. So this is regarding the introduction of the curriculum as a whole. So to begin with, the paper of physical chemistry, from which I am going to discuss with you the topic solutions, which is requiring 6 lectures, and it involves the points such as introduction, what is meant by ideal solutions, Raoult's law, vapor pressure, composition, and very interesting part, that is distillation of miscible liquid pairs. There are 3 types of these miscible liquid pairs, called zeotropic, type number 1, type number 2, azeotropic with minimum boiling point, and type number 3, azeotropic with maximum boiling point. You may feel confused with these big words, newer terms are introduced. What is zeotropic? What is azeotropic? What is distillation? Don't be afraid of these terms, because in the due course of our lecture time, you will get acquainted with these terms very, very well. It is very easy. Remember, it is very easy and interesting. Okay? So, to begin with this topic, solution. What is solution? Solution is a mixture of solute and solvent. What is solute? Solute is anything which is getting dissolved, in a simple language. For example, if we take a glass of water and add some salt or sugar in that, what will happen? The sugar or salt will get dissolved in this, and after some time we shall be getting a homogeneous solution, homogeneous mixture of solvent which is dissolving the solute, and the solute which is getting dissolved in the solvent. So what we see, a solution? Solution is a mixture, of course, homogeneous mixture of solute and solvent. So solute, whatever gets dissolved is solute. And what is solvent? Yes, in which the solute is getting dissolved, that is called solvent. So this is very simple definition of solute, solvent, and solution. So solution can be defined as homogeneous mixture of 2 or even more components. Now, what are the components? What kind of a components can be a solute or solvent? The solute as well as solvent can be a solid, liquid, or gas. So, if solute is solid or liquid or gas, and if at the same time solvent is solid, liquid or gas, there will be number of different types of solutions. Okay, these types of solutions will depend on the nature of the solute and nature of the solvent. Okay, so if solute can be solid, liquid or gas, at the same time solvent also can be solid, liquid or gas. So the solution will be named after that solute and solvent. Let us see various types or examples of these different types of solutions in the next slide. The first type is solution of solid in solid. So here solute is solid and solvent is also a solid. What is an example of this? Alloy, for example steel, is a mixture, homogeneous mixture or solution of carbon and iron. So the example of this type of solution of solid in solid is alloy, for example steel. Another type is where the solute is solid and the solvent is liquid. The solution will be named as solution of solid in liquid. What is the example? Yes, solid salt like sodium chloride in water. Very easy example. Another type is solution of solid in gas. The example is iodine vapors in air. If you keep iodine exposed to air, it is sublimed, it is getting evaporated in air, and the solid, very fine minute particles of iodine get dissolved or mixed into the air. So this is the example of a solution of solid in gas. Next type is solution of liquid in solid. The example is mercury in gold. Another very familiar example, another familiar type of the homogeneous mixture is liquid in liquid. The example is alcohol in water or any miscible liquid in water. Another type is liquid in gas. Here the solute is liquid and the solvent is gas. For example, moisture in air. In rainy days, the air, the atmosphere is full of water droplets in air and we call it a humidity. Another type is solution of gas in solid. For example, hydrogen in palladium. While studying various reduction reactions, we must have come across this example of a catalyst. This is an example of gas in solid. Another type is the solution of gas in liquid. For example, carbon dioxide in cold drinks. And the ninth type is the solution of gas in gas. The example is air. So these are different 9 types based on the nature of the solute and nature of the solvent. Why we have bifurcated these different types of solutions? These are bifurcated or classified based on the nature of the solute and solvent. The solution is named after the solute and solvent. Here while considering the two chemical entities out of which one is solvent and another one is solute. How to decide which one is solvent and which one is solute? Okay, how to decide? For this, take into consideration the proportion of the two. So if these two are the constituents which are going to get mixed into each other, whatever is in a less proportion as compared to the other, as compared to the other component, then whatever that is present in a lesser proportion is considered as solute, and whichever component which is in a greater proportion is called a solvent. Very simple. So whatever component which is present in a less composition or proportion is named as solute, and whichever is in a greater proportion is named as solvent. Remember very well. What will happen if two liquids are brought together? We are going to discuss this year very interesting example of liquid-liquid mixtures. What will happen if A liquid is mixed with B liquid? A is any liquid, B is any liquid. There will be three different options for these two liquids to behave together. What will happen if A and B are mixed together? Let us see the example in a slide. This is the first option where liquid A and liquid B, if these are mixed together, they give rise to a homogeneous mixture, that is solution of A and B. If A and B are completely miscible into each other, they give rise to a mixture of A and B. We cannot differentiate from this solution which is A and which is B, because both of these have been mixed together homogeneously. So whenever A and B are completely miscible into each other, they give rise to a solution, homogeneous mixture. There is another option, A and B are partially miscible into each other. When this is the case, where A is mixed into B, they give rise to something like this. The container is having two different layers. One is lower layer, another one is upper layer, but these do not belong to pure A or pure B, but these two are solutions in which one component is in a major proportion, another component is in a minor proportion. So one layer will be of solution of A in B, and second, another layer will be of solution of B in A. No way these two are the pure liquids A and B, but these are the solutions. This is the case observation when the two liquids are partially miscible into each other. So this is second option if two liquids are brought together. Third option is completely immiscible. A is not at all getting mixed into B. So if A and B are mixed together or added together, they produce two different layers. One layer is belonging to pure A, another layer is belonging to pure B. These two are separated from each other by this bounding surface or border. So this is the third option. If the two liquids are brought together, they can be completely immiscible into each other. Why we are going to see this? The two liquids when brought together either can be completely miscible into each other, or can be completely immiscible into each other, or can be partially miscible into each other. This year we are going to study in this topic solution how to separate these two components A and B from each other from their mixture. So what are the different methods of separation and the principle behind that separation? We are going to study this year. So remember these three different behaviors of the liquids. If two liquids are brought together, there are three options for these. Either these are completely miscible or completely immiscible, or these can be partially miscible. This can be remembered well from this slide. The two liquids have these three options. First of all, in today's lecture, we are going to see the types of completely miscible solutions. There are three types of completely miscible solutions based on their ideal or non-ideal behavior. Now, what is this ideal or non-ideal behavior? Yes, for the ideal citizens, there are laws, okay, rules, etc. We have to follow these rules. If any person follows these rules, we call that an ideal citizen. Okay. Very similarly, in chemistry, we have certain laws or rules. These rules, if these are followed by these chemical substances, these are named as ideal. Okay. So what is this law which decides the ideal or non-ideal behavior of the solution? We are going to study these laws in a very simple manner. Of course, don't forget, it is very interesting. This is called Raoult's law. The Raoult's law decides whether the solution is ideal or non-ideal. For example, whatever three types of solutions we have seen in the previous slide, type 1 are the solutions which are named as ideal or nearly ideal solutions because they obey the Raoult's law. They obey the Raoult's law. Type 2 and type 3 do not obey the Raoult's law. Now, what is the difference between type 2 and 3? We are going to study this, come to know this, when we will understand what is Raoult's law. Okay? So type 1 ideal, type 2 and 3 are non-ideal solutions. The difference between the non-ideal behavior of the type 2 and type 3 can be elaborated that type 2 is showing positive deviation from Raoult's law and type 3 solutions are showing negative deviations from the Raoult's law. So, type 1 is ideal, which are obeying the Raoult's law. Type 2 show positive deviation from Raoult's law and type 3 shows negative deviation from Raoult's law. Remember well. Now what is this Raoult's law? for this complete understanding of Raoult's law, we must know what is vapor pressure, what is Dalton's law, and then we will be studying the Raoult's law. Do you remember this particular diagram? In the first year BSc, you must have come across the definition, the concept of vapor pressure of pure liquid. If in a beaker or a container a liquid is placed and it is covered with a bell jar, the liquid, after some time, the liquid molecules get evaporated and there will be a pressure created by these vapors. At a particular temperature, this vaporization is happening, and due to this vaporization, to the extent of the vaporization, it is deciding the pressure created by the vapors, that is vapor pressure. So we must know every liquid is having its own vapor pressure at the particular temperature. If temperature is increased, of course the liquid molecules will start boiling, evaporation will be more vapors will be formed, and therefore they will create more vapor pressure. So vapor pressure of liquid is proportional to the temperature. Okay, so this is the concept of vapor pressure. If at all we mix some non-volatile solute into this volatile solvent, what will happen? This is also you have studied in the first year or even 11th and 12th standard, the concept of colligative properties, the first property, lowering of vapor pressure. What happens in this case? If non-volatile solute is mixed with volatile solvent, some of the sites on the surface are occupied by the non-volatile solute particles, and they create some hindrance to the evaporation process. Okay, so when such mixing of non-volatile solute is there, the evaporation will be less. Okay, it is reduced, it is decreased, and therefore less number of vapor molecules will be there, and they will of course create the less vapor pressure. So if non-volatile solute is added into the volatile solvent, there will be a lowering of vapor pressure. The vapor pressure is found to be lowered or decreased or reduced. We also know this concept. Now, if the two volatile liquids are mixed together, okay, if two liquids which are completely miscible into each other, and suppose both of them are volatile. Now, what is meant by volatile? The liquid which gets evaporated at a normal temperature, or we can say below 100 degrees Celsius, is called volatile liquid. And if both the liquids are volatile, what will happen? Both the liquids will create their vapors, and the vapors which are gathered here will create their vapor pressure, which is a pressure of vapor pressure of the solution. So total vapor pressure here, PS, vapor pressure of the solution, is nothing but this is the vapor pressure. Partly it is created by the vapors of component A, and partly it is created by the vapors of component B. And therefore, whatever vapors of A are there, they create their own vapor pressure called PA, and similarly, the contribution of molecules of B into the total vapor pressure is PB. So PS is nothing but the sum of PA and PB. PS is equal to PA plus PB. This is nothing but the Dalton's law of partial pressures. What is partial pressure? Out of the total vapor pressure, the part of the vapor pressure created by the vapors of one component is nothing but the partial pressure. So PA is partial pressure of A and PB is partial pressure of B, and together, as these two are the only constituents in this binary liquid mixture, the PS is equal to the total vapor pressure of solution is equal to PA plus PB. This is nothing but Dalton's law of partial pressures. Okay, so you must have understood what is vapor pressure and what is Dalton's law. Now we shall discuss what is Raoult's law. Raoult's law states that the vapor pressure of each chemical component in an ideal solution is dependent on the vapor pressure of the individual component and the mole fraction of the component present in the solution. So what is Raoult's law? Partial pressure of any component, it is decided by two factors. Of course, we have seen the example as in the diagram. If A is mixed with B and if A and B are both volatile liquids, then A will evaporate, B will also evaporate. The vapors of A contribute in the total vapor pressure. The vapor pressure will be named as partial pressure of A. Now, what are these two different factors on which this partial pressure will be dependent? Yes, first thing, the volatility of that particular liquid, the nature. If the boiling point of the liquid is very less, then it will evaporate very fast. Okay, so the partial pressure of the component will be decided by this factor, if the liquid is more volatile or less volatile, right? So volatility, it is measured in terms of vapor pressure. So if at a temperature liquid A is having more vapor pressure, that means A is getting evaporated more, and therefore more the vapors, more is the vapor pressure. Okay, so nature of the liquid is important factor which decides the partial pressure of the liquid. Another component, another factor which will decide this partial pressure is the proportion of that liquid in the mixture. If in the mixture that more volatile component is present in very little proportion, okay, the proportion itself is very less, then it will evaporate and create less number of vapors. So component, the composition of the liquid mixture is important. So the vapor pressure, partial pressure of the component A or B is decided by these two factors. What is the nature of that liquid? Whether it is more volatile or less volatile, that is the vapor pressure of the liquid itself at that particular temperature. Okay, so nature of the liquid, that is vapor pressure of the liquid when it is in a pure form. Okay, vapor pressure of the pure component. And second factor, how much that liquid component is present in the liquid mixture. If it is present in a less proportion, it will create less vapors and less will be the partial pressure of that liquid. If it is present in a major proportion, then of course more vapors will be created and more vapors will create more vapor pressure. Very simple law, Raoult's law. It is stating that the vapor pressure of each chemical component is dependent on two factors. One is vapor pressure of the liquid and mole fraction, that is proportion of that particular component in the mixture. Mathematically, this is expressed as PA, partial pressure of A, is equal to P0A into XA. XA is a mole fraction of A and P0A is vapor pressure of pure component A. The product of these two is nothing but the partial pressure. Regarding B, we can write PB, that is partial pressure of B, is nothing but the product of mole fraction of B, that is how much of B is present in the mixture, and the pressure, vapor pressure of pure component B. So PA and PB are expressed with these two mathematical expressions. And we have known the Dalton's law, the sum of these two will be the vapor pressure of the solution or total vapor pressure. So P0A and P0B are vapor pressures of pure components A and B, and XA and XB are the mole fractions. What is meant by mole fraction? We are going to see this. And Dalton's law of partial pressures states that PS, the total vapor pressure, is equal to PA plus PB. It is the sum of the partial pressures of the two components. So PS is nothing but P0A into XA plus P0B into XB. What is XA and XB? These are the mole fractions. If MA and MB are the number of moles of A and B in the solution, then total number of moles present in the binary solution of A and B will be MA plus MB. Then mole fraction of A, that is XA, is nothing but number of moles of A present in the solution divided by the sum of the number of moles of all the constituents present in the solution. Here only A and B are the constituents. It is a binary solution and therefore MA by MA plus MB is nothing but XA, that is mole fraction of A. Similarly, the mole fraction of B is given by MB divided by MA plus MB. Of course, as it is a binary solution, the sum of the mole fractions of both the components is equal to 1. Now, before proceeding further, let me see your questions, if at all you have written in the chat box. Yes, no questions. So let me proceed further with this lecture. We are going to see a demonstration of drawing of the graph. We know very well the graph is having some characteristic features like axis, points, lines, curves, etc. While drawing these diagrams, which is a major and important part of this topic, we are going to suppose one thing, that liquid A is more volatile than liquid B. This is very important part, because you will come across various textbooks and reference books and you may get confused with the diagrams, the graphs which are given in the books. That may be due to one fact. What is the nature of liquid A and B, which is considered while drawing those diagrams? In simple words, in this particular topic, if you remember very well, you will be very much clear about your assumption that liquid A you have considered, which is more volatile than B. Now, what will happen if liquid A is more volatile than B? More volatile, that means it will evaporate more. If it is getting evaporated more, then definitely the vapors of A will be more. Okay? Again, if vapor pressure is plotted, the vapor pressure point of A will be at the higher level as compared to the another less volatile component B. Okay? If you remember this particular theme in your mind very well, that A, we have supposed that A is more volatile than B, then the diagrams will be very well understood and very easily drawn by you without any confusion, remember. Okay? So how to draw this diagram? First of all, we shall draw the x-axis, then the y-axis, another limiting axis we have drawn at the right hand side, which is indicating that mole fraction has been plotted against x-axis. Mole fraction, as it is a sum of xA and xB, at the extreme left of the x-axis, xA is equal to 1. So it is pure liquid A at the left end of the x-axis. And to the right, mole fraction of B is 1, that is pure B is at the end of this. So meanwhile, these all points on this x-axis represent the various mixtures of various compositions. At this particular point, it is only pure A, B is totally absent. At this particular point, it is only B, A is absent. And along this line, the various mixtures of A and B are there. So at this point, XA is 1, so XB will be 0. 100%. So if pure liquid A is there, and suppose this is the point, this is the graph of vapor pressure against mole fraction. If A is more volatile, then this point will represent the vapor pressure of pure A. As the proportion of A goes on decreasing on the right hand side, the vapor pressure of A also will go on decreasing. Partial pressure of the A will also go on decreasing. Why? Because the proportion of A is getting decreased, and therefore the proportion of vapors in the solution will contribute less and less in the total vapor pressure. Okay, so this is the line representing the vapor pressure of, or partial pressure of A component. This is the point which is at the lower level as compared to this. Why? Because B is, we have assumed that it is less volatile as compared to A. So A is more volatile, more vapors are created and therefore vapor pressure is more. B is less volatile, so less vapors are created, which will create less vapor pressure, and therefore the vapor pressure of B is less as compared to A. As the proportion of B goes on decreasing from right hand side to left hand side, the partial pressure of B will also go on decreasing, and it will come to zero when no B will be present at this particular point. So when A and B are mixed together, this line will represent the total vapor pressure. Total vapor pressure, that is vapor pressure of A, partial pressure of A plus partial pressure of B. So these are the A and B points, and AB will represent the total vapor pressure. This line will represent partial pressure of B. This line will represent partial pressure of A, and this is the total vapor pressure. This is the demonstration how we are going to draw the graphical representation. So we have seen there are three types of solutions. Type 1 is ideal solution. Which obeys the Raoult's law. The diagram will be composed of three straight lines representing these three equations of three straight lines. So the diagram will be like this. This is straight line, this is straight line, and this is also a straight line, because these are the three equations which are representing these three straight lines. So if ideal solution is there, the liquid A and liquid B, when mixed together, if these are obeying the Raoult's law, that means if their partial pressure is the product of mole fraction and vapor pressure of pure liquid, that is P0A into XA, if this is the partial pressure of A, and if this is the partial pressure of B, then these three straight lines are observed in the diagram. Even vapor pressure is plotted against the composition or mole fraction. If we consider type number 2, the non-ideal solutions which show positive deviations from Raoult's law. Now what is meant by positive deviation? The expected ideal behavior is that PA is equal to P0A into XA. Similarly, we have these two equations also. But this is the ideal condition as per the Raoult's law. But positive deviations, that means in this type number 2 liquid, non-ideal solutions, the deviations are such that the partial pressure of A is greater than this product. Partial pressure of B is also greater than this product. And therefore, the solution pressure or total vapor pressure is also greater than the sum of these two partial pressures. So instead of having such straight lines in the graph, what we will observe is these curves. Remember well, this point of maximum is above this point A. Maximum, it is even above this point A. Okay, so these are the three curves obtained in the graphical representation if we plot vapor pressure against composition. This will be the nature of the graph. Here we can know the positive deviation from Raoult's law is seen. So this is type number 2 solutions, non-ideal solutions showing positive deviation. Okay. Third type is non-ideal solutions showing negative deviations from Raoult's law. So instead of having this ideal behavior, the observed deviations are such that we obtain three curves instead of three straight lines, because partial pressures are less than the expected value. And therefore, total vapor pressure is also less than the sum of the two partial pressures. So, observed diagram will be composed of three curves. If you observe this point of minimum, it will be even lower than the B. It is lower than the B. So, this is third type, non-ideal solutions showing negative deviations from Raoult's law. These are the three diagrams. Type number one, straight lines. Type number two, positive deviations, and therefore maximum is there, maximum point is there. Type number three, negative deviations, so there is a point of minimum in the graph. Now let us consider the next point, boiling point and vapor pressure. What is boiling point? Boiling point is the temperature at which the vapor pressure of the liquid becomes equal to the atmospheric pressure. Hence, boiling point is low for liquids with high vapor pressure and vice versa. How we can understand this? If any liquid is more volatile, that means it is getting evaporated even at low temperature. It is getting evaporated more, so more vapors are created, and therefore at a temperature given, that liquid is having more vapor pressure. So that more vapor pressure, it will require very little temperature rise so that it will be equal to the atmospheric pressure, because boiling point by definition is nothing but the temperature at which the liquid, the vapor pressure of the liquid, will be equal to the atmospheric pressure. Okay, so more volatile liquid will be itself, it will be creating more vapors at a normal temperature, and therefore more vapors will be creating more vapor pressure. So very little rise in the temperature is sufficient to make them equal to the atmospheric pressure. So more volatile liquid, or the liquid with more vapor pressure, will be having a lower boiling point. Okay, so more vapor pressure, less is the boiling point. At the same time, if less vapor pressure is there, more temperature will be required so that the vapor pressure will be equal to the atmospheric pressure. So the liquids with low or less vapor pressure will require more temperature to attain the boiling point. Okay, so boiling point is less for a liquid which have more vapor pressure, and the boiling point is more for the liquids with less vapor pressure. We can say boiling point is inversely proportional to the vapor pressure. Okay, so boiling point is low for liquids with high vapor pressure, and vice versa, that means boiling point is high for liquids with less vapor pressure. So type 1, type 2 and type 3, the diagrams of the vapor pressure against composition, if these three are the diagrams of type 1, 2 and 3 liquids, then automatically if we try to plot boiling point versus composition, then there will be a minimum instead of maximum here. Minimum will be there in the graph. Boiling point versus composition. This is the type 2 liquid pair where positive deviations from Raoult's law are seen, and therefore it is having minimum boiling point. Type 3 liquid shows negative deviations from Raoult's law, therefore minimum was there in the vapor pressure composition diagram. Here the liquid mixture whose vapor pressure is very low, it will boil at higher temperature, and therefore there will be a maximum in the diagram of boiling point versus composition. So these are the three different types, systems with intermediate boiling point. Why these are called intermediate boiling point? Because we can see the solutions, the mixtures will have the boiling points which are in between the two limits A and B, in between these two. So this is the type number one, ideal solution which is obeying Raoult's law and it is having intermediate boiling point. Whereas type 2 is system with minimum boiling point, that is it is having the minimum in the boiling point composition diagram. So it is having minimum boiling point, it is nothing but type number 2 solution. Third type is named as maximum boiling point, that is here we can see there is a maximum in the diagram of boiling point plotted against composition. So these are the three types of the liquid-liquid solutions. Type 1 is named as ideal or nearly ideal solution, it is obeying the Raoult's law. It is also named as system with intermediate or total vapor pressure or zeotropic solution. The vapor pressure is also intermediate and boiling point is also intermediate. So these are the different terms in which the type number 1 liquid solutions are described. Second type show negative deviations from Raoult's law. System has maximum total vapor pressure and minimum boiling point. Third is the top type where negative deviations are seen. The system with minimum in the total vapor pressure and maximum in the boiling point graph. So these are the different descriptions of the same type, type number 3. With any title there will be a question in the examination. So these are the different graphs of the same. In this particular slide I am explaining the examples of these along with the different names of the types. Type number 1, nearly ideal solutions, the examples are benzene plus toluene or benzene plus carbon tetrachloride or water and methanol. These are the examples of zeotropic mixtures or ideal solutions. The examples of type 2 are water and ethanol, benzene and ethanol. These are showing positive deviations from Raoult's law. Type 3 are non-ideal solutions where negative deviations are seen. The examples are acetone plus chloroform, water plus sulfuric acid. Now we are going to understand why the liquids behave differently. Why some liquid pairs are ideal and some are non-ideal? What is the reason behind this non-ideal behavior? The main reason is intermolecular forces of attraction. When these are comparable, the solutions are ideal. If these are less forces of attraction, positive deviations. If more attraction is there, negative deviations. It's quite easy to understand this. If two partners are there, A and B are cool with each other, they are just mixing together, they are not disturbing each other's individuality, this is an ideal mixture. Okay, even in the case of relationships, we can call it an ideal relationship. Okay, that these do not interfere into each other's individual interests, etc. So in case of these chemical compounds, we can say if the two liquids are there, and if the two liquid molecules are not having much or comparable, or we can say these are complementary to each other, just comparable with each other, these are just mixing into each other and not creating any type of interaction between them. There is no interference with each other. So this is the ideal situation. Okay, if at all, suppose A and B are very we can say they have some conflicts between them, what will happen? The molecules have very less forces of attraction with each other, even repulsions are there. What will happen in that case? A will evaporate more, B will also evaporate more. So less forces of attraction between the molecules will create the positive deviations from the ideal behavior. Positive in the sense evaporating more vapors will be created. And what will happen if the two liquids are having more forces of attraction with each other? The two molecules are keeping each other in the liquid form more, so there will be a less evaporation. When these are mixed together, both will have more intermolecular forces of attraction, and therefore they will create less number of vapors. So less vapors will be created, and therefore the partial pressure will be less than the expected value, and so is the total vapor pressure. Okay, so negative deviations will be seen where there will be more forces of attraction between the two molecules. Okay, so this is the reason the intermolecular forces of attraction, when these are comparable with each other, the solutions are ideal. If forces of attraction are less, there will be positive deviations. If forces of attraction are more, negative deviations are seen. Already I have extended some more minutes, so with this last point I will be stopping my lecture. Kolmogorov's rule, of course, in the next lecture we shall be having a brief revision of this point. Very quickly I shall complete this point. Vapors are always richer in that component which is more volatile, addition of which causes increase in the vapor pressure, lowering of the boiling point. Very interesting point is there. This point let us consider in the next lecture. So here we shall be ending this lecture number 1. Very soon you will be given a feedback link for this lecture. I'm expecting your frank opinion about various aspects of this lecture. I will request you to join any one of the platforms of learning management system, Edmodo, Canvas or Google Classroom. If at all by any reason you are not able to watch this YouTube live, I will be sharing with you the link of the video of this lecture. Okay, so all the best, and I'll stop here. Thank you.